Similarly, applying flavors. Now, keep one thing in mind. I think someone brought this up earlier. There are many groups from Darussalam that will board in America and land straight in Jeddah. Are you a part of one of those groups? Is that your group? Where you land directly in Jeddah? Some of you guys just know? If you're landing directly in Jeddah, from there you're going to go to Umrah. What I'm about to say right now really applies to you. So you need to pay attention very closely to what I'm going to say. If you're landing in Medina, or maybe you have a pit stop somewhere in the Middle East, it may or may not apply to you, but if you're boarding in Saudi Arabia, and then you're going to land directly in Jeddah, then going for Umrah, this really applies to you. These things that I'm listing that you need to do before you enter into the Haram, ideally, in an idealistic world, you would do them right before you put the Haram garment on. Which means what that would look like is, you have nail clippers ready for you, you cut your nails, you have a shaver or some sort of blade ready, you groom yourself, you apply fragrance on yourself, you wrap that garment on, you do your tour like that, you enter into the Haram. Ideally. But since you'll be boarding where? JFK, you're not going to have access to a razor if you do, you're going to be in trouble. You're not going to have access to a nail cutter. If you do, you're going to be in
trouble.
You're going to be in a lot of trouble. You're not supposed to have access to these things at airports. Okay? You may or may not have access to fragrance. Maybe you don't have it, maybe you do. So these things, you will do them as late as you can before you depart. Are you guys following? So if you depart, let's say for example, I'm leaving Dallas and I go to JFK and then from there I'm going to Jeddah. So before I leave my home for the airport, maybe an hour or two, a few hours before around that time, that's when I should go through this procedure that the Prophet was called through. It was also from the Sunnah of the Prophet that he would have an intimate relationship with his spouse. Aisha radiallahu anha says that before he entered into the Haram, he had an intimate relationship. Because when you're in a Haram, can you have intimacy with your spouse? So to push that desire away and to not think about it, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had an intimate relationship. So if one's at home, these are all things that can be done and probably should be done because these were the sunnah after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we talked about trimming one's mustache, removing pubic hair, clipping the nails, applying perfume. And also, it was from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to take a bath before entering into Haram. Now if a lady is in her menstruation, she will still take that bath. If a lady is in her menstruation, she will still take that bath. And a man will take that bath too. If for whatever reason you are not able to take that bath, let's say something comes up, you can't take it for whatever reason, then the bare minimum is wudu. That's why some scholars recommend. Keep in mind my scenario. Dallas 2?
JFK.
JFK, JFK 2? Jeddah, that's the scenario that I'm running right now. So even though I'll take a bath in Dallas, but before I put my ihram on in JFK, if I have access to water, I should do wudu. Are you guys following? Ideally, you should do wudu before you enter into the haram. If for whatever reason you cannot do wudu right before you enter into the haram, it is recommended. What's the key word there? Recommended to do wudu. If you cannot do wudu, you can still put the garments of the haram on. But you're going to face a complication, which I'll talk about in a moment. Now, we talk about putting on ihram. So we've bathed, we've groomed ourselves. Now it's time to put the garment on itself, enter into the state of ihram. It's important to know that the word ihram is a little tricky. The word ihram is a little tricky. Why? Because it refers to two things. It refers to a state and it refers to a garment. It's the same word that refers to two things. Okay? What does that mean? What that means is that the two sheets that men wear, what do we call that?
Ihram.
We call that ihram. Those sheets represent a state that we're actually in. Okay? So I'll give you a scenario. Let's say, for example, a man is in a state of ihram, so he's wearing two sheets. He goes to the washroom, he wants to relieve himself. If he takes those two sheets off, or even one of them, so that he's relieving himself, his clothes don't get dirty. He says, it's going to be a big mess, I'm going to take one sheet off and hang it. So if he takes one sheet off when using the bathroom, does that mean he's exited the ihram? Yes or no?
No,
why not? Because he's still in the state of ihram, even though he's not wearing the clothing of ihram. I'll run a second scenario. Let's say I'm in the state of Ihram and I still chai, I still some tea over my Ihram. I want to change it. Can I change the sheet?
Yes.
Yes. Because the garment only represents the state. What we are really concerned about is the state. We are concerned about the sheet, but not so much. You can change it if you want to, you can take it off if you want to. That we're not so concerned about. What are we really concerned about?
State.
Say it, guys. The state of the Ihram is what we are really concerned about. For sisters as well, what are we concerned about? The state of the Ihram. So don't be confused. Know that the word Ihram refers to two things, a garment and a state. We don't care so much about the garment. The garment has minimal implications, and it's something that you guys probably already know. Guys wear two sheets, women leave your face uncovered. That's it. That's more or less what the Ihram is. The garment. But we are much more concerned about the state of the Ihram because there are broader implications of the state of the Ihram. What does the word Ihram mean? The word Ihram comes in the meaning of declaring something haram, declaring something unlawful upon oneself. Because when we enter into a Ihram, there are certain things that become prohibited, certain things that become unlawful. What's an example of something that becomes unlawful when you enter into the state of the Ihram? Cutting nails, for example. Before you enter into the state of the Ihram, can you cut nails?
Yes.
Yes. Male or female, regardless. Once you're in the state of the Ihram, can you cut nails?
No.
You can't cut nails anymore. Okay. So when you enter into the state of the Ihram, there are certain things that become haram. Kind of like takbiratul tahrima. You know when you say Allahu Akbar at the beginning of your salah. By saying that Allahu Akbar, certain things become haram. For example, talking, walking, eating, drinking. Can you do these things in salah?
No.
So saying Allahu Akbar puts you into the state of salah. When you wear that garment of ihram and you do one or two things that are followed, it'll put you into the state of ihram. What is the ihram for men and what is the ihram for women? It is preferable for men to wear two white, new or washed sheets of cloth. New recommended, but you can use an old one too. Let's say, for example, you're going to Mecca, you wear an ihram, you use it. Now it's time for Hajj, you need to enter into ihram again. For men, you don't have to buy a new one. You can use the same one. Wear new or clean, washed sheets of cloth, one for the upper, one for the lower. So regarding the sheets, how many sheets are we wearing?
Two.
Two. It can be from any material you want. What did I say? Any material you want. It's your choice. White, but remember, legally speaking, you don't have to wear white. Legally speaking, you can wear any color. White is preferred because that was the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If you don't wear white, you're going to look really weird as well. Because guess what everyone else is going to be doing? We're all going to be walking white, okay? So you're going to look like the black sheep. So wear white, inshallah. Now the common question that we get from guys is that, I don't wear two white sheets in America. I wear underwear, I wear pants, I have a belt, I have a vest, I have a shirt, I have an overshirt, I button my shirts down. We really protect ourselves, you know, with all the buttons and belts and zips and all this other stuff. Isn't it going to be awkward just having two loose pieces of sheet around my body? Like if I sweat, will it slip off? Will I be humiliated in front of people? And I know it's awkward to talk about, but it is a concern. It's a concern that many people have. Because we aren't used to wearing two white pieces of cloth, you need to consider what you need to do to make yourself feel safe. Because where wearing the ihram is a sunnah act, if your body is exposed, that's not haram. So which one takes preference here? Making sure your awrah is covered, making sure your private area is covered, and you can pray properly and you're comfortable. So what are some things that you can do to save yourself from having that lower or upper garment fall off, which is the ultimate nightmare of every haji and muslim? Number one, safety pins. They work like magic. You just safety pin your upper piece, it's not going to fall off anymore. Another thing you can do, and some of the things that I'm going to say, you're going to raise your eyebrows and you're going to object. I have an idea what your objection is going to be, but I'll answer it. So feel free to object as you need to. What was the first thing I said? The second thing, you can use a belt for your lower garment. You know how you wear a belt for your pants? You can tie a belt around your lower garment. Some people, they choose a belt that has pockets in it, so they can use it as a pocket in your arm. You don't have pockets. If you want to put a speed in there, put a speed counter in there, put a swag in there, some loose change in there, some cash. So people will buy these waist belts. Another thing that some people do is that they use Velcro. They stitch Velcro, See that, the eyebrows that went up? I'll come to it. They stitch Velcro on their hand. And that Velcro will stick, which means what then? It won't fall off. Another thing some people do, and I'm gonna come back to this thing in a moment, so wait, let me finish off. Another thing some people do is that when it comes to the lower garment, instead of having the two edges separate, they'll bring the lower piece and bring the two edges together and sew them together, which will then create a cylinder. You guys understand that? By creating a cylinder now, because the two pieces are together, their septum will not be exposed. Their lower part of their body will not be exposed. So now the question, the obvious question is what? With regards to the Velcro and making this a cylinder?
Stitching.
Because we've always heard what?
Men
are supposed to wear unstitched garments. Any 50 manual you pick up from any madhab, when they discuss unstitched, that means the garment cannot be stitched at the shape of a limb of your body. What did I say? It cannot be stitched. The garment cannot be stitched to take the shape of the limb of your body. For example, if I were to stitch my lower piece in a way that my foot can slide into it like a sleeve for my pants, that would not be permissible. But if I make a cylinder out of it and it doesn't take the shape of one of the limbs of my body, it's permissible for me to stitch it. Stitching Velcro on an ihram is permissible because the Velcro itself is not a sleeve for my arm or a sleeve for my neck or a sleeve for one of my feet. You guys understand that? If, for example, you stitch your ihram in a way where your foot turns into ala hayati badin al wajuh. What's the fifth ruling? What's the statement? Ala hayati badin al wajuh. That it takes the shape of the body of the human being, like a pant does, like a sirwan does, or like a qamis does, where your sleeve goes through, or you have a gariban, you have like a collar area where you can put your head inside. That's what's actually prohibited. Ideally, if you can avoid the Velcro, if you can avoid making it a cylinder, whatever you can avoid, the better it is. But if you need to take precautions, then you take those precautions to make sure you are comfortable in your ihram. Now, for men, that's the two pieces. Then the other thing about men is that in your ihram, you need to make sure your face is uncovered, your head is uncovered, and a part of your foot is uncovered. I'll talk about the part of the foot in a moment. Your head is uncovered, what does that mean? No hats. Okay? You can use an umbrella that'll give you shade, that's okay, but you can't have a hat on your head. It's actually even permissible for you to carry a bag on your head. It's okay, even if it touches your head, you can do that. But you can't wear something. Again, the word there is wear. You can't wear something that will cover your head. Cover your head. When it comes to the face, you're not supposed to cover your face either. This goes both to men and women. You need to keep your face open. The limitations of the face is that part which you wash during wudu, which is from earlobe to earlobe, top of the forehead to the bottom of the chin. What is it? Earlobe to earlobe. Baseline of the hair to bottom of the chin. Now the common question here is what?
Face mask.
What about a face mask? Okay, is it permissible for me to wear a face mask? Ideally, it's better for you not to wear a face mask. That's the best case. Avoid wearing it if you can. If your health is such that if you don't wear a face mask, you're going to get very, very sick, then you have two options. The first option is wear it where you need to wear it. When you don't need to wear it, take it off. Are you guys following me? Wear it where you need to wear it. If you don't need to wear it, then take it off. The second scenario is that you need to wear it all the time because your lungs are just not good, or whatever it is, it's not good. You don't feel comfortable at all. You can't do this. A doctor has told you you need to wear a face mask. If you're that extreme and that in your situation, then wear it, but know that you will need to give a penalty at the end of the hajj. What did I say? If you cover your mouth with a mask or without a mask, if you cover your mouth, your face with a mask, for majority of a day is like 12 hours. This is the 12 hour thing. Majority of a day, 12 hours or more, if you're wearing a face mask, there's going to be a penalty. That's why I said take it off. What did I say to you guys? Let's say, for example, someone wears it for 1 hour and then takes it off for 5 hours. Then wears it again for 1 hour and takes it off for 5 hours. How many hours in total have they worn it? 2 hours. Is 2 hours less than 12 or more than 12?
Less than 12.
It's less than 12. If it's less than 12, they won't have a penalty. Okay? It has to be the majority of the day for the penalty to count. So that's that with regards to the face and head. Now with men we have special footwear that we need to wear. With women, that footwear doesn't really apply because you can wear everything you want. You can wear socks, you can wear shoes when it comes to your home. Footwear for men, what does that entail? The scholars differ in opinion. Some scholars are of the opinion that the ankle needs to be uncovered in a helm. What did I say?
Ankle.
So give your ankle a quick touch so you know where you're talking about. Your ankle touch, guys. Your ankle bone, that needs to be uncovered. Some scholars, the Hanafi scholars, they say it's not the ankle bone that needs to be uncovered, it's actually a part of the bone where the shoelace is.
Yeah.
What did I say? A part of the bone. So imagine this is my foot. This is my ankle. These are my toes. This is where my shoelace would be, right? So this much of that bone, look at me here. How much do I say? A part of that bone needs to be uncovered. That's why you'll find scholars recommending you wear flip-flops. Have you guys heard of that before? They recommend flip-flops. Why do they recommend flip-flops? So that this bone right here that your shoelace is lying on, it is uncovered. Fahimtum? Do you guys understand that? If you can find sandals that have a strap, one strap goes over, one strap goes under, and that bone is uncovered, you can wear sandals too. There's nothing in Sharia about wearing flip-flops. The reason why some scholars recommend it, according to the Hanafi scholars, this here needs to be uncovered. Another reason why scholars recommend flip-flops is because by wearing flip-flops, you follow both of these. Your ankle is uncovered, and so is this bone as well. Are you guys following that? So that's the difference of opinion regarding footwear. My recommendation is that when you have your footwear on, whatever you purchase something good. It's really, really, really worth it. I know you guys know this. But if you don't have good footwear, what happens to your body? It hurts your whole body. Your back's going to ache, your ankles are going to ache, your knees are going to ache because you cheap out on footwear. I would recommend put a little extra money and buy some nice Tevas. I'm not marketing other behalves. I'm just sharing my experience. Buy some Crocs, you know, something that will fit you, something that's comfortable with you. You're going to do a lot of walking, and the one thing that's really worth you investing, you know how people invest like $150, $200 in sleeping bags? When they go for hike, it's so not worth it. So not worth it. You know why it's not worth it? Because you're going to use that sleeping bag for 6 hours. Every year I've gone to hike. Inshallah, Allah allow me to land in the haram this year as well. This is going to be my 18th hajj. In all these years, I lie down in Muzdalifah on a cardboard. I buy a cardboard, I lie down because it takes 6 hours. It doesn't make sense for me to invest $200 for 6 hours. I wouldn't do that if I was in America. I'm not going to do it right there. Slippers, on the other hand, are really well done, really worth that investment. Why is that? Because you are going to wear them for days and days and days, a lot of walking. It'll save you from swelling in your feet, soreness. It'll save you from back pain, shoulder pain, knee pain, hip pain, all the other pains that are kind of like in line and also are connected with the foot. So I would definitely advise you guys to buy some good footwear that's comfortable to you. Reach out to your local scholar and then show them if you have any questions regarding footwear. Now regarding clothing of women. Women, your ihram, can we do the questions at the end? Women, your ihram is you wear whatever you want, you just can't cover your face. What did I say? You just can't cover your face. You can wear whatever you want. Socks, wear gloves, wear a shirt, wear pants, wear a abaya, wear whatever it is that you want to wear, you can wear it. You just cannot cover your face. There are some women who are persistent because they've always done hijab and they love in their life, so they want to wear something like a face nail. The way to do it is that they usually wear like a baseball cap. They'll wear a baseball cap and they'll wear this long sheet that will fall over the baseball cap so that way the cloth doesn't touch their face. That's a model some women create. It's okay, it's permitted. If you want to do it, you can do it. But you don't have to. The idea is what you're supposed to do is keep your face in front. Now with women, the one thing that you have to keep in mind is that you cannot cover a large portion of your face for more than half a day. You remember the half a day example I just gave earlier regarding the face covering? Yes or no? Yes. With women, that applies to, and where I see women making this mistake a lot, some women really wear their hijab low. You understand that? So their sheet is like this, which means the majority of their face is being covered. How much is being covered? From the side, all the way to the top, to the side. So when you're in a haram, you need to push it back a little bit. Not so much that your hair is exposed, but not here either. Right? I'm telling you, out of like 10 women, 7-8 of them will wear it right here. Or maybe just expose a little bit of their forehead. The whole side part is covered. It's going over their eyes, over their forehead. In the haram, you have to be careful with that. Because covering the majority of your face for a long period of time will result in a... And the result of the penalty. Be very careful. So we've groomed ourselves, we've selected our garments, now it's time to enter into haram. When entering into haram, it is recommended to pray two rak'ah before entering the state of the haram. So you've already put the garments on, you have the garments of haram on for a lady, you've uncovered your face. Before you enter into the state, you read two rak'ah. These two rak'ah are recommended. The Prophet in the first rak'ah read Surah Kafirun. In the second rak'ah, he read Surah Ikhlas. Surah Kafirun is a good surah. Ya ayyuhal kafirun na'abudu ma ta'budun. Surah Ikhlas is which surah? Qul huwallahu ahad. One rak'ah, seven. If a lady is in her menstruation, she will simply skip this part. It does not impact the validity of your rak'ah in any way. You just skip this part and go to the next step. For guys, you try to do this part. If you're in a plane, at the time when you're about to enter into the state of the haram, sit down and pray your two rak'ah. If you're at JFK and you're going to start your haram there, pray the two rak'ah there. If for whatever reason you sleep through it and there's no chance for you to pray the two rak'ah, then you can skip it. There will be no implication on your haram. If you recall a little while ago, I said to you guys, try to be in the state of wudu when you're entering the haram. Remember that? You know why it's so important to be in the state of wudu? Because these two rak'ahs. When you're getting ready to read these two rak'ah, you need to be in the state of wudu. That's why being in the state of wudu is really important. Pray the two rak'ah, and now we're ready to go to the next step. So let's do this again. What was the first thing? Grooming. You guys remember that? What were some things that we said in grooming? Quickly, go be fast. Nails, shaving, trimming,
perfume.
Fragrance, very good. Bathing, it's all kind of like one big thing, grooming all a part of that. Then after that, getting ready, what was the second thing? The garments of ihram. You guys remember? What were the two things for men? Two sheets, proper footwear. For women, what's the main thing for your ihram? Uncovering your face. Now we're talking about praying the two rak'ah. I said that you need to be in the state of wudu. And you need to, which surahs did I recommend? If you cannot pray, it does not affect your validity or state of ihram in any way at all. Now comes the next thing, which is how to enter into a haram. Entering into a haram, which are we on the mat?
Niyat al-bih.
Niyat al-haram? Okay. Then the one before that, you have that one, the little map one? You have that one? The blue, green, little circle, okay? Look like picture.
Yeah, I have.
You have that. Skip this. Skip down with the map. Okay. We're going to skip down. Okay, so entering into haram. In order for you to enter into haram, there are two things you must do. Without these two things, you do not... If you skip everything I said right now, everything I said, if you skip it all, there's a way to work around it. But if you skip these... But what I'm about to say, if you miss these two things, your haram is in haram. What are the two things you must do to enter into haram?
Niyyah.
You need to have the intention. I'm entering into haram. You don't have to say it. You just have to know it. I'm entering into haram. The second thing is talbiyah. Niyyah and talbiyah together will give you a haram. What is talbiyah? Anyone know? Labbaik Allahumma labbaik. Labbaik la sharika laka labbaik. Inna alhamda wa ni'mata laka wal mulk la sharika. This is one of the very few du'as you must know in your Hajj. Not that you should know, what did I say?
Must.
You must. Because without the talbiyah, your state of ihram in itself is in question. Whether you're in ihram or not. So in order to be in the state of ihram, you need to have an intention. What is an intention? It's something in the heart. You just need to know, oh Allah, I'm intending Umrah. Whatever you're intending to do with that ihram, you need to state it. So for example, if you're going to Umrah the first time, you need to say, oh Allah, I'm intending to do Umrah. Or for example, if you're going for Hajj, you need to say, oh Allah, I'm intending to do Hajj. All of us are going for Hajj, so we're going to make that intention. Now, there are different types of Hajj. Hajj Ifrad, Qiran, Tamattu, which I'll talk about up ahead. Yes? There is no place in the deen where you are mandated to verbalize your intention. What did I say? That's a principle. I just said a principle to you. What did I say? There is no place in the entire deen, in the entire Islam, where you are mandated to verbalize your intention. You don't have to ever verbally state your intention. Wherever scholars say that you should say your intention, that's a recommendation. We recommend that you say your intention so that it confirms what your heart already knows. But otherwise, you never, ever, ever have to say your intention. Okay? You understand that? So, one of the recommended du'as the scholars recommend is, Allahumma inni uridu al-umrata fayassirha li wa taqabbalha min. Oh Allah, I intend umrah, so make it easy for me and accept for me. After you've made the intention, now you need to say the tahbiyah. Labbayk, Allahumma labbayk, labbayk la sharika laka labbayk, inna alhamda wa ni'mata laka wal mulk la sharika. There are many verses the Prophet ﷺ shares regarding the talbiyah. Sa'd ibn Sa'd ibn Sa'd said, the Prophet ﷺ said, when a Muslim recites the talbiyah, then verily every stone tree and even the ground around him recites the talbiyah to the end of the earth. Meaning as you recite the talbiyah, everything around you, all the creation is joining you. With a voice that you can't hear, glorifying Allah, labbayk, O Allah, we are here. Talbiyah should be recited as much as possible. Men should recite the talbiyah loudly, not shouting it, but loudly. And women should recite the talbiyah not quietly, but softly. So you're not shouting it, you're not loud, you're not quiet either. Keep yourself busy and engaged in reading the talbiyah. Now let's go back to slide number 11 items. 11 items. The one that has an excellent in the white picture. Regarding the miqat. Yep. Got it? Okay. When should the haram be worn? Don't look at the screen. Please don't look at it. Look at it. I'm going to explain something very specifically to you in easy words to give you attention. Do any of you guys have a pen and paper in hand? Yes. If you have a pen and paper, I'm going to ask you to draw an image. So you're going to draw this. What you're going to do is in the middle, draw a square. Looking like God. This is important. This is really going to help. Trust me, everyone. Inshallah. You're going to draw a square that looks like the Kaaba. So, like, color it a little bit so you know it's the Kaaba. Put a nice little cute K next to it. Just kidding. That's a Kaaba. Then, maybe like an inch away from that Kaaba, draw a circle that goes all the way around. Like an inch away from your Kaaba, draw one circle that goes all the way around. Then an inch away from that circle, outside it, draw a second circle. So what you should have is one big circle, a smaller circle, and in the middle, the Kaaba. You guys have that? Now, the area between the Kaaba and the first circle, that area between the one inch in the middle, right there, right column. What are you going to write? Haram. For those of you that are looking at the screen, that's the green area. That green area, what is that called? Haram. That's the first area between the Kaaba and the first circle. And then between the two circles, what you can see on the screen as a blue area, you're going to write, call that Hil. What's the word? Hil. H-I-L. Hil. Ha-lam. Hil. That's what you're going to call. Outside the second circle, which is all white in our picture right here, all that all white area, you're going to call that afat or ufuk, or afat, one of the two. Afat, or the singular, that would be ufuk. You got, so what are the three words we have? The one closer to the Kaaba is called? Haram, then? Jinn, and then? Afat, or ufuk. Okay. Now pay attention, don't look at the screen, don't look at the screen, because it's going to cause you confusion. I want you to look at me. I want to explain it to you, then we read together what it says on the screen. Anyone that enters with the intention of going to Makkah, anyone from outside the second circle, which is Afaq. We are all in the Afaq. Where are we right now? We are all in the Afaq right now. We're outside the second circle. Anyone that intends to go to Makkah for Hajj and Umrah, Hajj or Umrah, Hajj and Umrah, regardless, to Makkah Mukarramah, they must wear the ihram from that second line. You guys understand that? They must wear their ihram from where? The second line. That second line is commonly called the Miqat. What do they usually call that second line, the one outside? What do they call it? The Miqat. So if someone is going for Hajj, where must they tie their ihram by?
The Miqat.
If someone is going for Umrah, where must they tie their ihram from?
The Miqat.
Fahimtum? Simple. Let's say someone lives in between the two lines, which is colored in blue. See that blue area? What did we call that?
Hill.
If someone lives between the hill, when they go for Hajj and Umrah, they tie their ihram from home. What do they do? So Jeddah is considered to be in the hill. The people who live in Jeddah, when they go for Hajj and Umrah, where do they tie their ihram from?
Home.
They at home, they take a shower, put their ihram on, they head off. They don't have to go to the Miqat anymore because they live in the hill area. Are you guys with me so far?
Yeah.
The third scenario is you live in the green area, which means you live in the haram. If you live in the haram, when you intend Hajj, you tie your ihram from home. When you intend Hajj, you tie your ihram from home. But when you intend Umrah, you have to go to the boundary of the haram, the first circle. People call, usually there's a place by that first circle, the place there is called Masjid Aisha. What's the name of that masjid?
Aisha.
Usually people go there. So if you do one, let's say for example, let's run a scenario. You guys understand that so far? Let's run one scenario. I'm coming from Dallas, going to Mecca for Umrah. Where do I tie my ihram from?
Miqat.
Okay? I arrive in Mecca, I'm done, just chilling in Mecca, enjoying my time. Hajj comes. Where do I tie my ihram from now for Hajj? From my home. Right? Because where am I? I'm in the haram. Now, let's say Hajj passes by 2 weeks later, I'm still in Mecca, just chilling, and I say, man, just say to one of my friends, let's go for Umrah. So when we want to go for Umrah, where do we need to tie our ihram from? From the first circle. It's called the haram boundary. What is that called? The haram boundary. I need to go there. I'm going to run the second scenario. Pay attention. I'm going from Dallas to visit some relatives in Jeddah. I'm going to spend 24 hours with them, and then I'm going to Mecca. You guys understand that? Where's my first pit stop? Which means I don't need to wear a ihram. So I go from America, I go to Jeddah, normal pants, shirt. So I've crossed the Miqat in normal pants, in shirt, whatever clothes I pull, whatever you wear. I chill for 24 hours. Now it's time for me to go to Umrah. My cousin's going to go drop me off. Where do I tie my ihram from? From home. Now you guys understand. Now look at the screen and read. It'll make a lot of sense to you. Okay? One must enter into the state of the ihram before passing the Miqat boundary. Do you guys agree? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes. Miqat is the outer boundary from where those wishing to perform Hajj or Umrah must enter into the state of the ihram. Do you guys agree?
Yes.
Is that statement correct?
Yes.
There are five boundaries for the Miqat, 5 points. And those are just the points that are listed. The furthest one is the one that's north. It's called Zulhulaifah. What is it called?
Zulhulaifah.
That's the boundary from Medina. For those of you who go to Medina first and then are going to Makkah, you're going to wear your ihram from Zulhulaifah. That's where you're going to wear your ihram from. If you're coming from Pakistan, India, or Dubai, you're going to pass Dabt. And if you're coming from Europe, you're going to pass Al-Jahba. So that's basically kind of like the direction you'll be crossing when you're entering into Makkah. Okay, so we have all that done. Let's go to the forbidden acts during the ihram. Abdullah, I believe that's 5 minutes.
Which one?
15.
15.
What was that term?
What do you mean by Mia? You
said Mia.
Huh?
You
said Mia for 5.
Yes.
You're making Umrah, so.
Mia the Umrah, then? Yes. Four lines, you know, Umrah, that's it. You don't have to even say it in your heart, you know, I'm doing Umrah, that's enough. If you're doing Hajj on behalf of someone, when you're making the Mia, you need to say that person's name. Oh Allah, I'm intending Hajj on behalf of Fulan ibn Fulan, so and so, the son of so and so. Make it easy for me, accept it for you. What are things that are forbidden to do while in ihram? Obviously, you should stay away from sinning foul language, fighting, quarreling, these are all strictly prohibited. لا رفض ولا سوق ولا جدال حتى الحج. It's really tempting, by the way. You guys know that, right? I mean, think about it. You've paid over $10,000 to go for Hajj, and you're hot, you're wearing two pieces of cloth, you're covered in sweat. Tell me you don't have the desire to rant and just really lash it on someone. But that's Hajj, isn't it? That's Hajj. You humble yourself, stay calm, control yourself. All forms of intimacy with one's spouse, which includes intimately hugging, intimately kissing, wearing day-to-day clothes like clothes, shirt, when you're at home, you don't wear that stuff, you just wear the two pieces of cloth for men, for women, you can wear whatever you like. Using perfume and fragrance are not allowed in hell. You cannot apply fragrance to yourself. You should even avoid using fragrance toothpaste. You should avoid it. You should avoid using deodorant that's fragrance. You should avoid using shampoo or soap that's fragrant. If you do use it, then will there be a penalty or not? There's a principle. Some scholars say if you use soap that has fragrance in it, then there will be a penalty. Why? Because it's fragrance. End of story. Another group of scholars, they say that there will not be a penalty because the soap you use, you did not use it with the intention of fragrance, rather you used it with the intention of cleaning yourself. So because it was tanzeef, not tatayyub, there will be no penalty. But there is a difference in between amongst the scholars. The best way to steer clear is disappointment. Go to your local Walgreens and find like unscented soap. Take it with you. When you're in the haram, I don't think most people realize this, but I'll just tell you guys something. When you're in the haram, let's say for example, you wear that haram an hour before you land in Jeddah. Okay? How long are you in the haram for when you're during Umrah? 24 hours tops. You land in Jeddah an hour later. Maybe at the airport you might have to sit there 6 hours, 7 hours, 8 hours, 10 hours, I don't know, 3 hours. Let's just use the worst case scenario and say 10 hours. 1 hour to get to Mecca, that's 12 hours done. The Umrah itself will take you 3 to 4 hours. So within like 20 hours, you're already out of Iraq. So don't make a big deal out of it. That's my whole point. Don't go crazy shopping and buying like 10 different shampoos and 10 different soaps. You're only in the haram during the Umrah period for 1 day maximum. And for Hajj, 2.5 days. How many days? 2.5 days. Less than 70 hours in the haram. So don't go shopping crazy and start buying all these crazy exotic little accessories because they're not really needed. On one side you have 70 hours, on the other side you have 24 hours tops. These are all exaggerated numbers. I don't want to push it. So, what you buy for one person usually is enough for 5-6 people. Like, if you have 5 people going for Umrah together, just buy like one bar of soap and 5 people can use it. Or not even, probably 10 people can use it, but that's going to get a little nasty. So, 5 people can use it, or you can buy some shampoo and 5 people can easily use it. It is also prohibited to remove bodily hair. To comb, to pluck, to trim, shaving the beard, these are all things that are prohibited. Even by those women too. If your hair naturally sheds for men or women, that's not a problem. The problem is what? You're pulling it out, you're yanking it out. That's a problem. Clipping the nails is prohibited. Wearing footwear that covers the shoelace area is also prohibited. Or, according to the other opinion, that covers the ankle, that's also prohibited. Moving forward, acts that are also prohibited in the haram. For a male to cover the head with something that touches the head, for example, putting your head inside a sleeping bag, or for example, a hat on the head, or tying your head over your head. The female to let a cloth touch her face in a manner that it is touching her face. So pulling your sheet over your face, that's not permission. Not permissible when you're sleeping. You can lie with your face downwards, but you can't put a sheet over your face. It applies to both men and women. If you're in a haram, you see the person sleeping next to you and they cover their face, what should you do? Uncover. Because if they sleep for a long period in that state, what's going to happen? There's going to be a penalty. So to save them the penalty is uncover their face, and that'll be a big thing. To hunt and kill, that's also not permitted. To kill lice is also not permitted. It becomes permissible if it's unbearable, then it becomes permissible. Otherwise, you're not supposed to kill any insects or any animals unless they become threatening to you. The snake is coming at you, kill it. But just for the sake of it, you're not supposed to go around and kill it. What are things that are permissible to do while you're in the haram? Number one, it's permissible to take a shower for purification and for coolness. It's really hot, you're burning up. You just take a shower to cool your body down. Completely permissible. Using unscented soap. However, it's not preferable not to remove dirt. So Allah likes the state of the human being that they're dirty when they come in front of Allah. Usually that's not a good state to be in, but the Hajj Allah likes it like that. So when you do use soap, use it if you're removing grease from your hand or if you're removing any najasa from your body, any impurity that you may have. Otherwise, just pour water on yourself, cool yourself down, but try to avoid using soap. It's permissible to use injections, band-aids, wearing sunglasses, wash, changing a diaper is permissible, using a swab is permissible. It is permissible to wrap yourself in a blanket, however you have to keep your face and head uncovered. It's permissible to wear a belt. It's permissible to kill scorpions, snakes, mosquitoes, wasps, and flies, because these are all things that can harm you. If these cannot harm you, then you're not supposed to be killing them either. Are we good on that? Any questions related to ihram? Raise your hands. Yes? You can use alcohol swab, you can use hand sanitizer. Can you use medicated ointments? As long as they don't have a fragrance. If they don't have a good scent, they're permitted to be used. If they have a good scent, like someone asked me, can I use Vicks? I'm like, sure, it's like when it has a scent. I said, you wear that to your babies? Like, it's not a good scent. It's a smell. It's a stench. It's a bad smell. Really. It's not a good scent. Any other questions? Yes.
There are some people who have problems with their wounds. They need a bag, putting that on their back, or
completely okay. Completely okay to have a brace on your knee or a back brace. It's all completely okay. Yes.
And how about pulling your beard, especially after wudu?
That's okay. Just don't yank hair out. Don't do this. We wouldn't. I'm just making that a point. If you're just combing your hair, fixing it a little bit, that's completely okay. Yes, at the back.
Stitch
what? Yes, stitch flip flops. They're completely okay. It cannot take the shape of a limb of your body. That's what's not okay. Sisters, any questions? Yes.
Did you say the hand sanitizer, which has alcohol, is okay?
Yeah, sure. I mean, the alcohol that's prohibited in Islam is wine intoxicating. That alcohol that hand sanitizer, if you drink it, it won't intoxicate you, inshallah, it'll kill you. Absolutely. Yes. A lady will keep her head covered. Yes, she can even need a helmet, sneaky or not. She can uncover it. You can uncover it if you want to. No one's there, no you're amongst women or amongst your husband, you're gonna take your scarf off. Sure, you can do that. Yes. What's the penalty? The penalty discussion is one of the more sophisticated, complicated issues in Hajj. I won't discuss that here. If you ever read something or do something that you shouldn't have done, it's best that you reach out to the scholar. Because they will view the circumstances and give a fatwa. There are so many issues, there are at least four different issues that have to be considered when you're giving a penalty. And I don't want that to be misunderstood by the crowd here, so I'm not going to share that. We will not be covering Babu Jinayat. We will not cover the issue on relating to penalties in this class. I'll just mention that there could be a penalty, which means if that happens, you need to get an ask. Go ask someone. Yes?
So I have a question on perfume. Initially, when you groom yourself, you put perfume on.
Yes.
But once you have worn the two sheets.
Once you're in the state of ihram,
then you cannot.
Then you cannot. So before you enter into the state of ihram, let's say for example, 5 minutes from now, I'm going to make talqiyah and niyyah. 5 minutes to the left. Until I don't make the talqiyah, until I don't make my niyyah, am I in ihram? I'm technically not in the state of ihram. So right now, I just take a bunch of fragrance and I dump it all over myself. No fragrance among you. Then what happens is...
Just some questions.
Other questions? Okay, did you have one? Yes. And then 5 minutes later, I enter into ihram. I can still wear that garment that I had on. I can keep that one on. But I can't apply any more fragrance, or I can't change into another garment that has fragrance on. I can only walk into a ihram wearing fragrance on the garments that I am wearing when I enter into the ihram. Fahim, can you understand that? Yes.
And if you use that around the second time, and it had the fragrance on for the first time?
That's completely okay. If you wear that, you apply fragrance once, you enter into a ihram, you then exit the ihram, and the next 2 days later it's time for Hajj, you're wearing that same ihram again, that's okay. because you're entering a common. We'll do like three more questions. Yes. One, two, and three. Sisters, any questions? Oh, wow, so many. I don't know. Yes.
Unscented
for
sunscreen.
Is there something? Is there even scented sunscreen? That's a thing. Stuff stinks.
That's why it's scented.
My kids are all in the dark. Yeah, the sun is really okay. That's good. Well, another question. What is it, the sister? The brother's always here to catch and ask. What would it do, sister's question? Yes?
If you're lost, like a woman gets lost or is displaced with a mahram, where can you still finish the ritual?
If a lady is not with her mahram, can she finish off her talaq? Yes, she can. A lady in Islam is not required to be stitched to a man. She is required to be with a man during the active state of traveling. You understand? لَا تُسَافِرَنَا إِلَّا وَمَعَهَا مَحْرَمٌ. What does that mean? That while the actual traveling is happening, that's when, let's say for example, I had a daughter someday, inshallah, who wants to go study in Azhar University. Can she study there? If I take her there, she can study there. Once she's there, I don't need to be there anymore. You understand? I need to be with her until she arrives in Azhar. I can drop her off there, turn back around, come back home. Not that I would, but I'm just making a point. When she arrives in Qahira, in Egypt, can she be there in Cairo alone?
Yes.
Because she's not actively traveling anymore. She is now technically a muqeem. Once she becomes a muqeem, she can be there herself. The issue is what? The actual act of safar itself. Last question. Sister, someone had a question. Yes.
Can you give content answers?
You can hear content answers, yes you can. That would be the slack if you finished. What is the minimum requirement? Oh, who has a question online too? Two questions came in. Is there a penalty for accidentally lighting the beast during the tawaf and umrah? No, there isn't. Can you wear socks during the tawaf and or sari in the state of the haram? Women can wear socks, men cannot wear socks. What is the minimum requirement of performing wudu? The minimum requirement for wudu is that you cover your face in water even one time, will suffice. Wash your arms, including the elbows, right once is enough, left is enough, one time is enough. Wipe over your head and wash your feet, including the ankles. You must wash each of them once with the condition that the entire limb is soaked. If the limb is not washed, then you must wash it a second time. If it's still not washed, then you must wash it again. You need to keep washing it until the whole thing is washed. That's the end of the story. Okay, let's move forward. We have a lot to cover, guys. I know you have a lot of questions. Gene.
Question about putting on the fragments before the imam. Once you put on the fragments on you and then you put that imam on, that fragments is going to get on that imam as well. And there is a tendency that certain fragments will stay in the imam. They do not get off even if
that's all recommended. This is all recommended. You're supposed to put fragrance on your body, which is supposed to touch the ihram, which is supposed to stay as long as it can.
So it doesn't put any damage to you after?
It's all recommended. This is exactly what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before he entered into the ihram, he said to Aisha radiallahu anha, come put fragrance on me. She put fragrance on him. He said, more. She said, I put more on. He said, put more. She said, I put more on. He said, put more. She said, I put more on. She put so much on that the fragrance was on him, it was also on the ihram as well. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam read the tanbiyah in that state. You can directly put it on too. The only problem with putting them directly, it's a little tricky, but I'll share with you anyway. The scholars have seen you should not put the fragrance on directly in a way that it has a visible trace. It can't stain your ihram. It's a little tricky, but that's one issue. It can't, what did I say?
Stain
your ihram. Don't ask any questions on that. Just leave it at that. That is the one that I go. That's okay. Leave it at that. Okay, let's continue. If you guys ask all the questions now, we won't get to Hajj. Women give up prayer on the inshallah. Oh! Can we bring, I understand your question.
No.
My answer is still the same, though. I'm going to explain it, though. My answer is going to be the same. Can a woman put fragrance on? What's my answer? It's going to be similar. Yes, because I have to fix it a little. I have to like fine tune it. There is a famous scholar by the name of Allama Munawi Rahmatullahi Alayhi. He's a famous commentator of Hadith. What's his name? Allama Al-Munawi. He is from the teachers of Imam Nawawi Rahmatullahi Alayhi. From Imam Nawawi Rahmatullahi Alayhi's teachers and above. Allama Munawi Rahmatullahi Alayhi, famous commentator of Hadith. When he came to the narration that prohibits women applying fragrance, he was asked by his students that what is the explanation of this Hadith? Allama Munawi Rahmatullahi Alayhi wrote, while explaining that Hadith, he said this prohibition is when the common area, the public area, is predominantly populated by one gender. So in the markets at that time, which gender was mainly there? Men were. So the Hadith said to the women that if you're going off, which is going to be a one-off visit, don't apply fragrance. That's the first thing. The second thing Allama Munawi then says, moving forward after this, because in our day and age, the public area, is it the public domain, is it mainly populated by one gender or both?
No,
both. That's clear. The second thing Allama Munawi says is that when it comes to women, if a lady wants to be more careful because of the warning of this Hadith, if she wants to be careful, she should apply fragrance in a manner where it doesn't spread rather than sticks to her. So like a body spray. Where the body, what happens when the spray? It sticks to you, it doesn't spread everywhere. And the second thing that he writes, and this is a practical point he writes, he says if a lady applies fragrance to herself and then covers that area with a garment, let's say you spray by your neck and then you wrap a hijab around, so that fragrance doesn't spread, it sticks with you, he says this is the best model you can take. So let's say, for example, if she applies a fragrance and then she wears a shirt on top, or wears like a chadar or sheet on top, or wears a cardigan on top, these are all circumstances where there is no blame on the lady at all. Okay, moving forward. Umrah itself. The Umrah consists of three major steps. How many steps?
Three.
The first is the Tawaf. The second is Sa'i. The third is Halaq / Qasam, which means to trim or shave your hair. What are the three things?
Tawaf,
Sa'i, trim or shave your hair. These are the three steps. We'll go through each one by one in more detail. Okay. Entering into Mecca. Upon entering the city of Mecca, one will be taken to the hotel, place your baggage in the hotel. If you are really tired and it is not time for prayer, it is advisable to rest before Umrah. Umrah can take many hours in peak seasons, like the high season, and therefore requires plenty of energy. If one is traveling with an elderly or someone who is unwell, it may be a wise idea to perform Umrah at night when the heat is less. One should engage in reciting tasbihah all the while. So the summary of this is don't rush. خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانِ عَجُوبِ. The insan is very quick. Rush. Don't do that with your Umrah. Because if you rush yourself in Umrah, what's going to happen? You won't focus. This is your once in a lifetime opportunity. Every step should be meaningful. Every step should be purposeful. Your heart should be leaking with du'as, pouring over, overflowing with du'as every step you take. So don't rush yourself with your Umrah. Take your time. If you need to have a meal, do that. You need to wash up, do that. Take a little shower, do that. Have some food, go sleep for a little bit, wake up, take some medicine if you need to. You know, whatever it is that you need to do, do that. When you're fresh, then go for your Umrah. Okay. Now another thing, alhamdulillah, I found Rasulullah Salam to be excellent with this one issue. But if you're not, if for whatever reason, you know someone that's going outside of Salam and you have to advise them, the one thing you need to be very careful of is that usually when you arrive in Mecca or in Medina, after you come from your international flight and you arrive in your hotel, for some reason the Saudi hotels take a very long time giving you rooms. Have any of you guys gone to Hajj or Umrah before? Have you experienced this?
Yes.
It's painful. Because what happens is, look at this, you've been traveling now for 18 hours on a flight. Very possibly, if you landed in Jeddah, you sat there for another 10 hours. So what are we at now? 28 hours. A 2-hour bus drive to Mecca. What are we at? 30. And sometimes these Saudi hotel guys, even the Hilton, some of these top better hotels, they can make you sit in the hotel lobby for 4 hours. And you're like, come on. I can't go for home enough for 4 hours. I'm waiting here so I can go to the room, lie down, kind of just rest up. Be patient. That's my advice to you. I know it's easy for me to say, hard to do, but just be patient. Keep yourself busy. Keep yourself engaged. Don't destroy it. You're just about to, inshallah, just about to have yourself forgiven. Don't cross that. There are many historical sites in Makkah Mukarramah that are encouraged to visit. We're going to skip all of this. We're going to jump to slide number 23. We're going to jump to 23. Entering Masjid al-Haram. Now it's time to enter into the mosque. So you've rested, you're going to the Umrah, or you're going to the Masjid for the Umrah. The Umrah, for those of you who haven't been before and have no idea what we're talking about, the Umrah requires you to be inside Masjid al-Haram. It all happens inside the Haram Mosque. So you need to enter inside the mosque. Therefore, we'll walk you through the etiquette of entering inside the mosque. We'll talk about laying the first lance on the Kaaba and the virtue of that and what to do. And then we'll talk about the Umrah itself. So entering the mosque. Enter with the right foot, reading the du'as and reciting salawat upon the Prophet. Salawat upon the Prophet means? Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, as we say in Persian, durud. Proceed to the Kaaba with the utmost humbleness. Reach the place where the Kaaba is clearly visible, which is not obstructing others. Stop and make du'a as soon as you see it. This is a very sacred place and time for the acceptance of du'a. When the Prophet came to a place from where he could view the Kaaba, he would make du'a. That's it. When the Prophet saw the Kaaba, he raised his hands and he made du'a. Narrated by Imam Shafi'i and also in Sunan al-Kubra. The Prophet, there's a lot of virtue just at looking at the Kaaba. In one hadith, the Prophet said, every day 120, not every day, every moment, 120 special virtues are descended down upon the Kaaba. 60 of them go to those performing tawaf, 40 of them go to those praying salah, and 20 of them go just to those looking at the Kaaba. So there's a lot of virtue just sitting there looking at the Kaaba too. By the way, this hadith is narrated by Imam Suyuti rahmatullahi alayhi and others as well. Imam Bayhaqi rahmatullahi alayhi and virtues of Hajj. So sitting and looking at the Kaaba has a lot of virtue as well. Ibn Abbas said, gazing at the Kaaba is faith. The Tabi'i Sayyid said, whoever looks at the Kaaba in faith and belief will be freed of sins. It says sins there, but sins. Like the day his mother delivered him. Then we have this image of the Kaaba. Hold on to the book. I think it's page 28. 27, we have this nice, beautiful picture. 28, we have the image of the Kaaba. This image of the Kaaba gives you a directory of what is around the Kaaba, what to keep your eye out for, what things you need to be aware of. Now it's time for us to go into Salah. Before we go into Salah, should we take a break? Would you guys like a break right now? 5 minute break? Then we'll go into Salah, which will lead us to Hajj, inshallah, and we'll finish off. So it's 4:12 right now. How many minutes do you need? So let's go until 4:20. How about that? I think that's 7 minutes. We'll break up, inshallah. During the Q&A, during the break, I have one request from you. Please give me a virtue. I'd love to say salam to all of you. I'll give it from here. As-salamu alaykum. I need a little bit.